the path of the just is like a shining light, shining bright as the noonday.
Hello and welcome to Walking in the Word. Today we are going to continue our look into Romans 8 and talking today about being an advocate. So starting in Romans 8, verse 23, let's pick up with this thought. And not only so, but ourselves also, who have the first fruits of the Spirit. The word first fruits, let's break that down before we go on. We have the first fruits of the Spirit. What exactly does that mean? The word first fruit, as you look at the definition up in the Greek dictionary, it means a compound of away from, the concept of away from, and the rest of the compound is to commence or proceed. It was the beginning of a sacrifice. In the Jewish Old Testament requirements, they had to bring the first fruits of everything they sacrificed so that it would be the perfect or the most whole, the most pure. So the concept here of first fruits of the Spirit, if you just look at the definition of the word, it opens up a whole new realm of understanding. So again, the word first fruit, as in the first fruit of the Spirit, means a compound of away from. The word away from, it's the word apo, which we've talked about that before, how it means like to take away. A veil is to apo, to take away. So away from and to commence or proceed. So it means to basically to go from the starting point and move forward, to move away from the beginning, which means to go through, to walk through the process. So the first fruits of the Spirit is not maybe like we've understood in the past that you get the baptism of the Holy Spirit and that's all that there is. No, that's the beginning point. The first fruit implies that you start at that point of being filled with the Holy Spirit, and then you walk on, you proceed on there through the development spiritually of growing up again spiritually. Think of Paul's words in Romans 12, 1 and 2, which says, I beseech you therefore, brothers, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice. So again, we know Old Testament law, the first fruits were required for sacrifice. They were the most pure. So Paul said, present your bodies a living sacrifice. Just think of how the lambs and the oxen were sacrificed. They were presented to the priest as a sacrifice or an offering. So present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but what? Be transformed by the renewing of your mind in order to prove by you what is good and pleasant, pleasing and perfect, the perfect will of God. What is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God, the King James says. And I love what my husband says about the difference between the Old Testament sacrifices and the New Testament sacrifices. In the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament, the sacrifices always died. But in the New Testament, New Covenant sacrifices live. We actually live and live more abundantly the more that we allow to be sacrificed in our old way of living and take on more of the new and the nature of Jesus Christ. Then we live not just a little bit, but we live more abundantly each time. Verse 23, the second part of Romans 8:23 says, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, awaiting adoption, the redemption of our body. And we talked about how that's the sound, whole, spirit, soul, and body last time. Verse 24, let's pick up with that now. Romans 8:24 says, for we are saved by hope. And saved, as we said before, the word sozo means to deliver, to protect, to heal, to do well, to make whole, to preserve. So we are all of that by hope. And hope just doesn't mean a little thought, well, maybe this is going to happen. Hope by definition means expectation, confidence, and even faith. So we are saved by faith. And we know that in church history, Martin Luther came to the place where he made that realization right there in black and white in Scripture that the just shall live by faith, right? So we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen, the verse continues, is not hope. If you see it, you don't hope for it because you already have it. For what anyone sees, why does he hope for it? Verse 25, 825 says this, but if we hope for that which we do not see, then we wait for it with patience. And the word patience, definition-wise, means hopeful, endurance. It means constancy. We continue on. We proceed, starting at the beginning, the first fruits, but we walk on from there. We are constantly moving, but we're in patience and endurance and hopeful endurance. Romans 8:26 says, likewise, the Spirit also helps our infirmities, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. Again, if we think of what Paul said to us in our study in Galatians, Galatians chapter 4:19, let me just remind us of what he wrote there. He says, my little children, for whom I again travail in until Christ should be formed in you. So Paul, as a spiritual father and apostle, knew that there wasn't just a one and done. You ask Jesus into your heart, or you be filled with the Holy Spirit, and that's all there is. He said, I travail again in birth for you spiritually, so that Christ may be more fully formed in you, the nature of Christ. So he was a good father, and he travailed spiritually for his sons and daughters to be matured and to develop spiritually. So we know that he understands, the Holy Spirit understands our infirmities, because that's what verse 26 starts out saying. Likewise, the Spirit also helps our infirmities, for when we don't know how to pray, the Spirit Himself makes intercessions for us. And so this, I'm sure, is what Paul was experiencing. He wasn't physically travailing, obviously, but spiritually, there were groanings coming out of his spirit, directed by the Holy Spirit that was indwelling him. And those groanings were for the manifestation of spiritual maturity in his spiritual children, his sons and daughters. Those groanings just came out of Paul's voice, but the foundation of them were the Holy Spirit interceding through Paul for his sons and daughters. And we say groanings, that it says groanings for a reason. No travailing woman in labor, I'm sure, has ever written a poem or a book or a speech. The travail comes in the forms of groanings and deep utterances of travail. So Paul understood that. He experienced that as a spiritual father. He experienced those travailings, those longings, those prayers. And then Romans 8:27 says this, he, searching our heart, knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. So the Spirit of God makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And again, think about Paul's example we just talked about as he spoke about that in Galatians 4. There, I'm sure, were times that Paul was just under such a burden to see his sons and daughters grow spiritually, but he didn't have words to say. He didn't have a way to explain through prayer in his own language. So he would allow the Spirit to pray through him and to give voice to those burdens and those concerns, and praying in the Holy Spirit through the power of the Holy Spirit, he didn't have to have the words in his own language. He could just allow the Spirit of God to do the speaking through him. Another translation states Romans 8:27 this way, God, the searcher of the heart, knows fully our longings, yet he also understands the desires of the Spirit, because the Holy Spirit passionately pleads before God for us, his holy ones, in perfect harmony with God's plan and our destiny. So we have an advocate. We have an advocate. Jesus himself spoke these words in John 4:16, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. The word comforter in the Greek is parakletos, and it means an intercessor. It means a consoler. That's where the word comfort in the English would come into play. And an advocate. An advocate, an intercessor, a consoler, a comforter. So we have the Spirit of God for our ability to be able to pray even according to the will of the Father. And we know that this is a very, very powerful thing, that we have been given the power of the Holy Spirit and the intercession of the Holy Spirit to speak through us. Suter's Greek lexicon adds to the definition of the word parakletos. This is beautiful. One called in for support. One called in for support. And one who speaks in favor of. So know this, as you're praying in the Holy Spirit, there is one who is speaking through you, who's got you in their favor. They're looking out for your well-being. You're well-favored, and they're speaking on your behalf. The Spirit of God is speaking on your behalf and making intercession for you. We know the power of praying in the Spirit. Jude chapter 20 says that there's a personal benefit. And there it says, building up yourselves on your most holy faith. How? Praying in the Holy Spirit. And so as a good pastor friend of ours says, speaking or praying in your kingdom language will actually be like a spiritual battery that will charge you up. Just like plugging a battery in to be charged. So we can build ourselves up on our most holy faith by praying in the Holy Spirit. And again, letting the Comforter, letting the Advocate pray through us on behalf of our needs and our concerns, knowing that we have favor before God as this Advocate speaks through us. But also 1 Corinthians chapter 14, where Paul lays out the blueprint for how the spiritual language, the kingdom language, if you will, edifies the body of Christ. And there's a blueprint or an outline of how in the congregation, how praying in the Spirit or using your heavenly language can edify the whole body of Christ at that point. It says, I speak in tongues. This is interesting that Paul makes this statement in one verse in chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians. He said, I thank God that I speak in tongues more than you all. So if there was any evidence that Paul thought it was a good thing, again, keeping in mind that Paul, his ministry began after Jesus ascended. So the fact that he said, I'm thankful that I speak in tongues more than you all, he then lays out the blueprint of how that praying in the Spirit and speaking under the utterance of the Holy Spirit in the congregation can edify the church if there is an interpretation of that prayer, of that tongue. And we see that. I was grateful to grow up in a congregation where there were a lot of prophecies and a lot of tongues and interpretation of tongues. Again, you see that in 1 Corinthians, how that was the blueprint was set up to operate in the church. And so we can see that the Holy Spirit praying through us or even speaking through us in the congregation can build us up. It can build up the whole congregation. And He does intercede on behalf of us, the Spirit of God does. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to my husband, my sweetheart, and let him take the next round.
Thanks, dear. Starting in verse 29, we're all familiar with this, and we like to state it. It's a comforting thing to know, but it says, "And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose, for whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom He did predestinate, them He also called, and whom He called, them He also justified, and whom He justified, them He also glorified." Now, there's a lot of words here that have been misconstrued, and people get ahead of themselves in the thinking of it. Nancy brought forth about predestination, that some people thought you were predestined to be saved or not, and there was nothing you can do about it. And you see that a lot in Islam. You saw it in the church before Martin Luther did his theses on the wall, on the door at Wittenberg. And but to break down some of these words so that you know, it says, "And we know." You know, sometimes we think we know something, but we don't know it because we haven't been through it. And it's the Greek word eido. And if you've ever had somebody describe something to you, a concept or something, and finally the light bulb goes on, and you say, "Oh, I see." And that's what it means. I see it. I know it. Now I know it because I understand it. I got a vision, a vision of it. In the word things, all things. That word all is the word pas, and it also breaks down to the word pan or pan. We use that word pan a lot in English. We used to talk about the Pan American Airlines. It went to all the Americas, anywhere in America, north and south. Recently, we had a epidemic. The word demic means people. You see it a lot. Democracy, power to the people. Okay. So in this case, we're talking about epidemic means, epi means upon. So something that's upon the people. And in this case, it got so bad it was on all the people. So we called it a pandemic. That's where that word come from, in case you didn't know. And it means they wanted to give us the idea that it was on everybody. And so that word, we have to get the idea that all things, all these circumstances, all these different things that come against you, all of them are there to work together for good, okay? You may not see it right now, but it's going to happen. It's going to come out. God's going to see to it. Okay? All things work together. That word "work together" means soon ergeo. Okay? Soon, again, is the word that means together. And ergeo, if you remember your science, the word erg is a unit of work. Okay, so it's going to work together, and we're going to be a fellow worker. This thing that's going to work together is going to, right now you think it's coming against you, but it's going to end up being a fellow worker with you. And you know, we need to get that. We have to see. I just explained it to you. And so you don't just know it, but you need to see it. Okay? So don't get frustrated and don't get discouraged or anything like that. It's going to work together for good. The word agathos means for your benefit. Okay, you know any ladies named Agatha? That's what their name was, came from. To them that love the Lord, the word agape. If you remember Jesus trying to restore Peter, he said, Peter, you love me more than these? And Peter said, you know I do. You know I love you. But they were using two different words. Jesus was saying, do you agape me? And Peter is saying, I phileo you. Okay? He needs to step up his game and come into the place of agape love, which is a love that goes, jumps over every barrier, over every wall, like Joseph. He was a vine by a well that went over the wall, okay? And they break down all the barriers. They love you whether you're black or different nationality or a woman and a man or, you know, every little thing that we can make a split in, young and old, it doesn't matter. The love goes across all these boundaries, okay? And so then he said to them that love God and that are called, okay, that word called is the word kletos, and there's a whole bunch of words that come off of that, klesis and kaleo, okay? The church is the called out ones, ecclesia. It means they're called out. They're invited. They're appointed. They're even anointed. And so we have to understand that you are in that group. If you're listening to this, you're listening to it because you want to know more. And so you're trying to grow up into this. And so, and we're called according to his purpose. Okay? So that purpose means prothesis. It means what is his intention or what is his proposed thing for you that he wants you to come into. For whom he did foreknow, this is where people run into a problem. They think because he foreknow that forces you to be that. Okay? No, it doesn't. My dad had intentions for me, and I maybe didn't fulfill them because he had an idea what he wanted for me. But God knows where you're going to fit in. He has a purpose. And you will be miserable if you don't fulfill that purpose, not because he's going to make you miserable, but because you will have felt bad that you didn't come into it when you find out what you could have been. That weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth is going to be for people finding out they could have been something and they didn't. They didn't fulfill it. And so that purpose that he has for you is something that he's determined beforehand, or he's marked you out for it, okay? But it doesn't mean you still have a free will. And if, you know, the prodigal son, he and his brother both got the same inheritance from the father, which was life, eternal life. What are you going to do with it? One went and wasted it. And the other one stayed with the father, but he never picked up the father's heart. And so, you know, they both failed in a way. And so God doesn't want you to fail. He wants to give you every opportunity and everything you need to succeed. And so He has a purpose for you. And it says that he wants you to, that predestinate means that he determined beforehand and he marks you out. And then he wants you to be conformed. Okay, that word is sumorphos. There's that word sum again, together. Okay, and morphos means an adjustment of parts, shape, or nature. You think about that word is where we get metamorphosis from. Do you want to be changed from a caterpillar that grows around, grubs around on the ground and destroys plant life? Or do you want to go into a cocoon and be have your parts adjusted and your shape and your nature and come out a butterfly? Okay, in this case, we want to come out like Jesus. And then it says that we're going to be in the image of his son. The word icon, we've heard that word before. It means a likeness or a statue or a representation. In this case, we're going to be the real thing, not just a statue. And sometimes we make a statue because we think that's what somebody, something looks like or should look like. We don't want that. We want a representation and a likeness. He wants to he made us in his likeness, his image and likeness. And so then that we may be, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Okay? That firstborn is Prototokos. And he's going to be, we've heard people refer to Jesus as the pattern son. Okay? So we're all going to end up coming out like Jesus. And it's not some lockstep thing where we're a robot. No. We're going to have plenty of freedom in him. But it's going to be a freedom to do the right thing. Right now, we like choice. So you have a choice. I can do the right or wrong thing. Well, I don't want to. I'd rather get to the point where I only know right. And because I only know him. And he's going to direct me, and everything he directs me to do is right. So when you talk about being a mature son and being perfect, like Nancy said, it's not that you don't ever make a mistake. But you won't ever make a mistake because the only thing you will ever do is what the Father tells you to do. And he always tells you the right thing. Be ye perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. And so he's going to be the firstborn of many brethren. Okay? And that word brethren means you came out of the same womb. And you're going to be a brother, and you're going to be much like him. Okay? So I hope that this kind of clarifies some of these things, because just because we think God predestined us, it's still up to you to be a prodigal son or the son that sits around and doesn't take on what the nature of God is. Or you can do the right things and become that, much like Jesus. That's the whole idea of what the fivefold ministry is about. So I hope this helped you and clarified some of the words for you. And so we love you, and we just want to see you succeed just like God wants you to succeed. And we'll be praying for you. And so we love you, and we greet you, or we say so long to you till next time in the name of Jesus. Amen.